Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to tonight's Irving K. Barber Learning Center lecture, a special presentation of the Vancouver Institute at the Chan Center. This lecture is co-sponsored by the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives, 350.org, and Green College. I'm Chris Grauer, president of the Institute, and it's my privilege to introduce tonight's celebrated speaker. Before I do, I just want to point out that after the lecture, Ms. Klein will take questions, which will be collected by volunteers from the cue cards that have been passed out. Those will be brought up, and Ms. Klein will answer your questions then. Naomi Klein is, of course, an award-winning journalist, syndicated columnist, author of the international bestsellers The Shock Doctrine, The Rise of Disaster Capitalism, 2009, and No Logo, 2000. She writes a regular column for The Nation magazine and The Guardian newspaper, and is a contributing editor at Harper's Magazine. She is a Puffin Foundation Writing Fellow at The Nation Institute and a former Millibrand Fellow at the London School of Economics. Naomi serves on the board of directors of 350.org, one of our sponsors, the global grassroots movement to solve the climate crisis. That is, of course, the subject of her critically acclaimed new book, This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate, the 2014 winner of the prestigious Hillary Weston Writers Trust Prize for Nonfiction. Ms. Klein.
Thank you, Justice Grauer. I want to acknowledge that we are gathered on the unceded territory of the Musqueam people and thank our various hosts of the Vancouver Institute and also our co-sponsors, the BCCCPA, as well as my friends at 350 and Green College. I want to thank all of you for your patience in coming here. I know that there were lines involved, and I appreciate that. Tell your friends who couldn't make it that I'm sorry. And I want to give a big shout out to the people in the overflow room. Want to say hi to them? Hey. I have to believe that this is not just about this book. I've said on a few occasions that I think Stephen Harper should be getting royalties because he is this book's best publicist. Every day he's out there telling Canadians that they have to choose between acting to prevent the climate, climate catastrophe and having a healthy economy. That isn't true. But it is true that there's a fundamental clash between his ideological worldview, the economic system that he believes in, and the things we must do to address this crisis. That is something that a great many of us know, and that's why we're gathered here tonight. I also want to thank and acknowledge the many friends and family who are here tonight. Whenever I speak in Vancouver, it's always very much a family affair. I'm very pleased that tonight my husband Avi Lewis is here, who has been a collaborator in every way on this project and has just finished the fine cut of a film that he's been making alongside as a companion to the book that's going to be taking us deeper into the movements that I document. And Avi is here, my brother Seth Klein, my sister-in-law Christina Boyle, their 10-week-old son Aaron. So if you hear squawking, you're such a good boy. My parents, Bonnie and Michael Klein. One person who isn't here tonight is my own 2-year-old son Toma, who is home with a babysitter. He has mixed feelings about seeing me up on stage. He's been known to storm stages in the past. And that didn't seem appropriate in such a beautiful hall such as this, the Chan Center. But since he's not here, I thought I would begin. I know you're expecting a rabble-rousing speech, but I thought I'd begin by reading a very short section from the introduction to the book. What gets me most are not the scary scientific studies about melting glaciers, the ones I used to avoid. It's the books I read to my two-year-old. Looking for a Moose is one of his favorites. It's about a bunch of kids that really, really, really want to see a moose. They search high and low, through a forest, a swamp, in brambly bushes and up a mountain, for a long-legged, bulgy-nosed, branchy-antlered moose. Have you ever seen a moose? They ask on every page. The joke is that there are moose hiding everywhere, but they don't see them. And in the end, all the animals come out of hiding, and the ecstatic kids proclaim, "We've never, ever, ever, ever seen so many moose." Now, my son loves this book, and I have read it many times. And on about the 75th reading, it suddenly hit me. He might never see a moose. I tried to hold it together. I went back to my computer and began to write about my time in northern Alberta, tar sands country, where members of the Beaver Lake Cree First Nation told me about how the moose had changed. One woman described killing a moose on a hunting trip, only to find that the flesh had already turned green. I heard a lot about strange tumors too, which locals assumed had to do with the animals drinking water contaminated by tar sands toxins. But mostly, I just heard about how the moose were gone, and not just in Alberta. Rapid climate change turns North Woods into a moose graveyard, reads a May 2012 headline in Scientific American. A year and a half later, the New York Times was reporting that one of Minnesota's two moose populations had declined from 4,000 in the 1990s to just 100 today. Will he ever see a moose? Then the other day, I was slain by a miniature board book called Snuggle Wuggle. It involves different animals cuddling, with each posture given a ridiculously silly name. How does a bat hug, it asks. Topsy-turvy, topsy-turvy. For some reason, my son reliably cracks up at this page, and I explain that topsy-turvy means upside down because that's the way bats sleep. But all I can think about is the report of some 100,000 dead and dying bats raining down from the sky in the midst of record-breaking heat across Queensland, Australia, whole colonies devastated. Will he ever see a bat? I knew I was in trouble the other day when I found myself bargaining with starfish. Red and purple ones are ubiquitous on the rocky coast of British Columbia, where my parents live and where my son was born and where I've spent about half of my adult life. They're always the biggest kid pleasers because you can gently pick one up and give it a really good look. This is the best day of my life, my 7-year-old niece Miriam, visiting from Chicago, proclaimed after a long afternoon spent in the tide pools. But in the fall of 2013, stories began to appear about a strange wasting disease that was causing starfish along the Pacific coast to die in the tens of thousands. Termed the sea star wasting syndrome, multiple species were disintegrating alive, their vibrant bodies melting into distorted globs with legs falling off and bodies caving in. Scientists were mystified. As I read these stories, I caught myself praying for the invertebrates to hang in for just one more year. Long enough for my son, then one, to be amazed by them. Then I doubted myself. Maybe it's better if he never sees a starfish at all. Certainly not like this. When fear like that used to creep through my armor of climate change denial, I would do my utmost to stuff it away, change the channel, click past it. Now, I try to feel it. It seems to me that I owe it to my son, just as we all owe it to ourselves and to one another. But what should we do with this fear that comes from living on a planet that is dying, made less alive every day? First, accept that it won't go away, that it is a fully rational response to an unbearable reality. Next, use it. Fear is a survival response. Fear makes us run, it makes us leap, it makes us act superhuman. But we need somewhere to run to. Without that, the fear is only paralyzing. So the real trick, the only hope really, is to allow the terror of an unlivable future to be balanced and soothed by the prospect of building something much better than many of us had previously dared hope. Yes, there will be things we will lose. Luxuries some of us will have to give up, whole industries that will disappear. And it's too late to stop climate change from coming. It's already here, and increasingly brutal disasters are headed our way no matter what we do. But it is not too late to avert the worst. And there is still time to change ourselves so that we are less brutal to one another when those disasters strike. And that, it seems to me, is worth a great deal. Because the thing about a crisis this big, this all-encompassing, is that it changes everything. It changes what we can do, what we can hope for, what we can demand from ourselves and our leaders. It means there's a whole lot of stuff we've been told is inevitable that simply cannot stand. And it means there's a whole lot of stuff we've been told is impossible that has to start happening right away. Can we pull it off? All I know is that nothing is inevitable. Nothing except that climate change changes everything. And for a very brief time, the nature of that change is still up to us. Thank you. So that's the end of the reading part. Can I have a tiny little bit more house light? Just to see people's faces a little bit more. Thank you. Hi. All right. So I called the book This Changes Everything because this is where climate conversations in 2014 have to start. Where we are is a place where there are no non-radical options left on the table. If we stay on the road we're on, we face radical changes to our physical world. And this we know from our climate scientists, but we hear it also from some of our most conservative financial institutions. We hear it from the World Bank. We hear it from the Pentagon. We hear it from PricewaterhouseCoopers. We hear it from the International Energy Agency. They tell us that if we stay on the road we're on, we're headed towards 4 to 6 degrees of warming above pre-industrial levels. That's a problem. Our governments, when they went to Copenhagen in 2009, signed an agreement committing to keeping temperatures below 2 degrees warming. At the time, it was incredibly controversial. African delegates marched through the halls of the convention center, calling it genocide. Island nations chanted 1.5 to survive because 2 degrees was considered reckless, and yet we are headed towards 4 to 6 degrees. Everything changes about our physical world in that scenario. We don't know exactly what it means because climate models start to break down, but we know it means entire countries disappearing, major metropolises, massive crop failure. And all we have to do to arrive at that radical place is nothing. Just keep on keeping on. That road to 4 to 6 degrees is paved with new tar sands pipelines, new coal export terminals, new LNG terminals, new oil train infrastructure, new tar sands mines, new fracking fields. This is called business as usual. It's not exactly business as usual because the easy to access fossil fuels are gone. So the growth is in the so-called non-conventionals, the oil from the tar sands, the gas fracked and then converted to LNG. These are vastly higher emitting than their conventional counterparts because they're harder to access and to refine. It requires more energy to get that out. And these huge investments in infrastructure that locks us in for decades to come. Now, we all know this about the tar sands, right? But because we're here in BC, I think it's important to put to rest once and for all this myth that fracked gas is some kind of clean energy source. Shale gas derived from fracking has notoriously high rates of methane leakage. In the book, I call it the burning bridge, not the bridge fuel. Methane is an extraordinarily potent greenhouse gas, 34 times more effective at trapping heat than carbon dioxide. In the short term, 10 to 15 years, according to the IPCC, it's 86 times more powerful at trapping heat than carbon dioxide. So these new LNG terminals that we hear about in the paper every day, worth $20 billion, are being built to last. You don't invest $20 billion unless you plan on getting your money out over a period of 30 to 40 years. We're supposed to be off fossil fuels by then if we're going to stay within our global carbon budget. Christy Clark is obviously trying to have it both ways. She's marketing BC as a responsible climate leader, unlike Alberta. But you can't have it both ways. You cannot be a climate leader and simultaneously lock the province into a future built on dirty fossil fuels. That is the road that leads. That is the road that leads to catastrophic warming, the road that changes everything about our physical world, that forecloses on meeting the kinds of emission targets that gives us a fighting chance. And it also forecloses on making the necessary switch to renewables, because cheap gas is competing directly with wind and solar. That's the infrastructure we need to be spending billions on right now. All of the above... energy strategy that we hear about from Obama is a myth. And Sandra Steingraber, a wonderful biologist turned anti-fracking activist, I quote her in the book. She says, "We are standing at an energy crossroads. One signpost points to a future powered by digging fossil fuels from the ground and lighting them on fire. The other points to renewable energy. You cannot go in both directions at once. Subsidizing the infrastructure for one creates the disincentives for the other. BC is at its own carbon crossroads. And we're already a good way down that wrong road, all of us, collectively. But the good news is, it's not too late to swerve and prevent those radical changes. There is still time to keep temperatures below 2 degrees. But the catch is that this also involves radical changes to our political and economic systems. Because right now we have a system in the grips of an ideological project that is blocking the changes we need on every front. So in the book, I make the argument that if we want to understand why we have failed so catastrophically to rise to the challenge of climate change, why global emissions are up by 61% since our government started to meet and negotiate about lowering emissions, we need to understand the catastrophically poor timing that climate change has had as an issue, in that it landed on our laps at the worst possible moment in our ideological evolution, and that moment was 1988. 1988 was the year that James Hansen testified on Capitol Hill and said that he could now say with a high degree of certainty that there is a connection between greenhouse gas emissions and warming that they were already tracking. 1988 was the year that Canada, in Toronto, hosted the first intergovernmental meeting about climate change, where emission targets were discussed. 1988 was the year that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was first formed. It was the turning point. So this wasn't the year that we found out about climate change. Scientists have known about it for a long time. But 1988 was the year that we collectively lost all plausible deniability, and it became the issue of the day. 1988 was the year the editors of Time magazine, when it came time to choose their man of the year, they still called it a man of the year, chose planet Earth and put, you know, a big picture of planet Earth on the cover, our planet in peril. So what else was going on in 1988? Why was this such bad timing? Well, 1988 was the year that Canada and the US signed the first big free trade deal that was eventually expanded into NAFTA, that became the prototype for dozens of free trade deals to come, including the ones that are still coming at us. It was the year before the Berlin Wall collapsed and Francis Fukuyama declared history over, that there was only one way of governing. It was the ascendant moment for the neoliberal moment, what Joseph Stiglitz calls market fundamentalism. And this is the era we've been living in. It was the subject of my last book, of the shock doctrine, of how this ideology triumphed and spread around the world. We're all familiar with the pillars of this ideological project. They're privatization, deregulation, cuts to corporate taxes paid for with cuts to social spending, all locked in under those corporate free trade deals. And we're all sadly familiar with the impacts, the hollowing out of the manufacturing sector, the attacks on the social safety net, the scapegoating of immigrants, rising education costs, the slow privatization of healthcare by stealth, widening inequality year after year. Far less understood is that this same ideological project also made it pretty much inevitable that we would fail to rise to the challenge of climate change. And that's because climate change is the ultimate collective crisis. It requires that we cooperate in an unprecedented way within our countries and between our countries. It demands collective solutions, not just individual consumer ones. And yet, it hit us at a time when we were told that there was no such thing as a society by Margaret Thatcher, that we were just atomized, greed-seeking individuals, and by seeking our personal fulfillment, we would achieve the greatest possible collective good, so just go shopping. So not only did we have a political elite entirely in the thrall of this narrow worldview, but it seeped deeply into the environmental movement itself, which is why for so many years the only solutions we heard about had to do with addressing us as consumers as opposed to as political actors. Change your light bulbs, drive a hybrid, and then let's give businesses the sort of win-win incentives to act. We can't regulate them. No, that's communist. We have to create emission trading schemes like they did in Europe and so on, and the track record on that is pretty abysmal. But this has governed our response. And so, you know, I've heard a little bit since the book came out that I'm politicizing the issue of climate change and it should stay apolitical. But the way we have responded to climate change is deeply political. It's just that the politics that governs it is invisible because it is the dominant ideology of our time. But when you choose to favor individual consumer responses over collective responses to a collective crisis on this scale, that is highly political. So I'm going to be talking specifically about how that ideological project clashes specifically with what we have to do to rise to this climate moment, and why fundamentally we cannot avoid engaging in a true battle of ideas about what values and core principles should govern our society. This, in other words, this has to become a lot more political. But before I do that, I want to talk a little bit about power, and not the kind that turns the lights on and off. I want to talk about the kind of power that turns societies around. Because the climate debate is often really wonky. It's a lot of talk about very specific technocratic policies, as well as specific technologies, and not a lot of talk about why none of this is being rolled out on the scale that would actually make a difference and get global emissions pointing in the right direction. And the reason for that has a lot less to do with the mechanics of solar power than with political and economic power. So on the one side of this issue, on the one side of the climate debate, we have interest players that want no action at all. They are extremely motivated. These are the fossil fuel companies. They stand to lose trillions of dollars in so-called stranded assets if we decide to take climate change seriously. And I think we understand this particularly well since the research that really launched the divestment movement came out. The Carbon Tracker Institute in England came out with a sort of breakthrough research showing that the fossil fuel industry had 5 times more carbon in their proven reserves, carbon that is already counted towards their stock price, than the atmosphere can absorb and still leave us a 50-50 chance of staying below 2 degrees of warming. So in other words, if we keep our commitments, they lose trillions in assets. When that's the case, you fight hard. You are extremely motivated. You fight like you mean it. And indeed, that is how the fossil fuel sector has been fighting this battle. They've been fighting it dirty. They've been fighting with great passion and creativity. They've been buying off politicians. They've been spreading misinformation. They've been funding the climate change denial movement. That's one side. On the other side, you have some incredible climate activists, many of whom are in this room. But you also have a kind of a mushy middle liberal constituency that cares about climate change, but not just on a good day cares about it, you know? If you're asked to rank, there's actually a ranking in the US of where Americans are asked to rank 20 different issues on their relative importance, and climate change always comes in 20th. That's a really big problem. Because the reason why climate change has consistently been ignored at election time is because there is this perception, often rightly from politicians, that the people who want action care, but not that much. This is not going to be the issue that they vote over. They aren't passionate about it in the way that they're passionate about, say, jobs or healthcare. So they can afford to ignore it. This means that any serious plan to address the climate crisis needs more than the right technocratic policies and the right technological solutions, though those are really important, but we've actually known what those are for quite a long time. Any credible strategy has to have a plan for dealing with this immense imbalance of forces, this urgency gap that I've just described, this passion gap between the two sides on this issue. It needs a strategy to build a counterpower to the elite forces using their immense wealth to systematically block meaningful climate action. As far as I know, the only force that has ever been able to do battle against a small group of wealthy and powerful interests with a huge amount to lose is a much larger grouping of people, a movement made up of people with a great deal to gain. Now, I'm convinced that there can be a movement like that, but it needs to be grounded in economic and racial justice. If we build a movement, no, that's true, we can make a moral case for that. And in the book, I make a moral case for it. But it's also a strategic case. This is about how you win. If we build a movement that has as its goal the construction of a world that is not just cooler than the one we're headed to, but fairer, more equal, more generous on every level, then we actually have a shot at winning this titanic battle. Because people are ready to fight for a world like that. Now, I'm going to lay out in some detail a little bit about that clash, as I said, between the ideology and the things we need to do, but not to make us feel hopeless and trapped, but because I think that this points to how we can build that kind of coalition, that grand coalition, how climate change can weave together so many of our pre-existing movements. The good news is that we're not starting from scratch. So the most obvious way in which what we need to do to address climate change clashes with the current right-wing ideological project has to do with public spending, has to do with our relationship towards the public sphere, right? We live in a time of unrelenting austerity. We live in a time of unmaking the public sphere, not building it, not transforming it, not reimagining it. But if we are going to respond seriously to this crisis, and we need at this point to be getting our emissions down by 8 to 10% a year, that is what leading climate scientists at the Tyndall Center tell us. If we are going to stay within our carbon budget and address it with any degree of equity, countries like Canada and other countries of the global north need to be cutting our emissions by 8 to 10% a year. That's huge. And that doesn't happen unless you are making massive investments in the public sphere to lay out a new renewable energy grid, new transit systems, expanded rail, urban design that makes cars obsolete, all of that good stuff. But it also means investing in the public sphere to protect us from the storms that we have already locked in, that we can't avoid. Because we've seen over and over again that so-called natural disasters turn into true catastrophes when you have this lethal intersection between heavy weather and weak and neglected public infrastructure. This is sort of what, you know, I see this book in many ways as a sequel to the shock doctrine. The shock doctrine ends with Hurricane Katrina, where we saw that combination of that superstorm banging into those neglected levees that collapsed. The city flooded. It shouldn't have flooded. The levees should have held. And then we saw what it meant to have a truly hollowed out government, because FEMA, the agency that was tasked with responding to disaster, couldn't seem to find New Orleans for 5 days. And people were left on their rooftops. If you had money, you got in your car, you drove out, you checked into a hotel, you called your insurance agent. But if you depended on there actually being a functioning state to have some sort of evacuation plan, to actually be able to help people, you were out of luck. In fact, the state turned against the people of New Orleans, and they were met with profound violence. And of course, this was extremely racialized, who was left behind. It was overwhelmingly African Americans who were on their rooftops holding signs that said help, who are in the Superdome left without food, without water. It's important to remember this. This is a glimpse of the future we are building if we do not have this ideological shift. We saw it again during Hurricane Sandy, when you had this, once again, this repetition of an incredibly unequal experience of the storm with people who had money were pretty much okay. And now they all have invested in private generators. But if you were in public housing that had been neglected for so long, the lights were out for weeks when everybody else's lights were back on. These are tall buildings, you know, 22 stories. People couldn't get out. They were up there without elevators and without lights, without food. No one came. It was an absolute failure of a hollowed out state. So crises can be wake-up calls. You know, this is one of the things I talked about in the shock doctrine. When Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans, I mean, this was the moment that the sort of Bush presidency kind of ended, right? Because you even had right-wing columnists going, hey, where's big government? You kind of do want big government during a disaster, right? And this happened in England recently when there was historic flooding this past winter. And whole communities were underwater and cut off. And the response was very, very slow. And part of the reason it was so slow is because Britain has been in the grips of this austerity that has swept Europe. David Cameron, is really the poster child for austerity politics. And yet his base, his constituency, turned on him. They found out that he had dramatically cut back the agency that is charged with flood defense, the Environment Agency. And 300 flood defense programs had been killed in the years before the flood, even though climate scientists had been warning that there would be more and more flooding associated with climate change. More than 1,000 people had lost their jobs at the agency. Another 1,700 had their jobs slotted to be eliminated in coming months. So it was like, wait a minute. And so we heard words we never thought we would hear from David Cameron, like, money is no object in this relief effort. Whatever money is needed, it will be spent, right? Which is just a glimpse of how climate change, you know, if progressive forces are ready, can flip the tables on austerity politics. But it was also a glimpse about the stakes on this, and if we don't address this fundamental values question about the values that are going to govern our society, we are going to become more brutal, more xenophobic when disaster strikes. Because in the midst of all of this, the Daily Mail, which is a very right-wing newspaper in England, a tabloid, sort of Fox News in print, ran a front-page petition calling on the Cameron government to divert billions in foreign aid to helping flood victims at home. So this is pretty rich irony from the country that invented the coal-powered steam engine, right, and has been burning fossil fuels longer than anyone else. But the response is, forget about Bangladesh. We want the money for us. And you know, this is in the context of a country that is moving rapidly to the right, that has some very powerful, explicitly racist parties on the rise. So this is why we cannot avoid a deeper conversation about values, about what we believe. Climate change can be the best argument anti-austerity and anti-gentrification activists have ever had. Many of us in this room have been fighting public sector cuts for decades, defending affordable public education, universal health care, mass transit, the right to affordable housing close to that transit. Climate change can be our best hope for winning the massive investments in the public sphere that we need, ones that have the power to create huge numbers of unionized, well-paying jobs. We're going to be seeing Mark Lee from the BCCCPA, their wonderful senior economist who's published a whole bunch of great material as part of the Climate Justice Project at the CCPA, that shows that when you invest in transit, energy efficiency, and renewable energy, you create 7 to 8 times as many jobs as if you spend that money in oil and gas. And this is important research for us to be taking up. If we make those investments, it helps win the kinds of services that deliver real improvements in quality of life, whether it's public transit system or a rail system that moves people as opposed to oil, or energy-efficient, affordable homes. And I think in many ways what we often do is we don't even see the climate activism that is happening right in front of us. We don't even recognize it. You know, there were these huge protests ahead of the World Cup in Brazil, for instance, demanding free public transit. And I found it really striking at the time that nobody in the sort of mainstream climate movement said, hey, those people are fighting against climate change, even if they never say the word climate. Anybody who is fighting mass transit for everyone is a climate activist, and we need to change our definition and go to where people are at. When people in the downtown East Side are fighting against gentrification, a process that pushes transit users out of downtown and moves in people who drive their BMWs everywhere, they are climate activists, whether they're talking about climate change or not. Now, when we talk about these sorts of public investments, we always run up against the same problem, right? Which is that we're broke. We can't afford to bring transit to everyone. We can't afford to invest in public housing. And it is true that our governments tend to be broke. And it is also true that our governments are particularly broke since they bailed out the banks, our federal governments, based on the familiar model of privatized profits and socialized losses. Now, because we did this on such a spectacular scale so recently, there is simply no way for us to do the same thing for the fossil fuel companies and the big agribusiness companies that are at the heart of the climate crisis. We cannot let them pocket their huge profits while taking on the burden of cleaning up their messes. The response to this crisis, unlike the last one, must be guided by justice, and that means polluter pays. That means big polluters, but it also means super consumers, the highest income earners, people like me and a lot of you. There are all kinds of methods that can serve this purpose of progressive taxation, whether it's higher royalty rates from extraction or export taxes on exporting extractive industries, financial transaction taxes, luxury taxes. So in the book, I go through a long list of ways in which we can find the money, because it isn't that there is no money, it's that the money's in the wrong place. But it is certainly not going to happen with Christy Clark's current plan of paying off the polluters to please build their super warming LNG terminals in BC. That is a recipe for passing the bill for climate action onto working and unemployed people who are already paying, struggling to pay for heating and transit. It's been pretty interesting being here this week and watching this debate play out and how quickly any kind of a sort of progressive response to new extractive project falls away as soon as any kind of, there's any kind of hitch in the plan. And we're seeing this play out in real time. I actually think that really getting the polluter pays principle back on the agenda may be the most important impact of the growing fossil fuel divestment movement. This movement that is very much, has been catalyzed by that research I mentioned earlier that shows that the fossil fuel companies have five times more in their reserves than our atmosphere can absorb. This is a movement that's very powerful here at UBC. In January, 76.9% of the student body voted in favor of this university divesting its endowment from fossil fuels. Many faculty members have joined the movement, and tomorrow, I'm told, the Faculty Association is going to be voting on whether or not to have their own referendum on the question. So let's hope that UBC joins the slew of recent divestment victories that we're seeing around the world. Glasgow University announced a couple of weeks ago that it would be the first university in Europe to divest from fossil fuels. And then there was the rather stunning announcement a month ago that that members of the Rockefeller family, a name absolutely synonymous with fossil fuels, John D. Rockefeller, obviously the founder of Standard Oil, that eventually turned into to Exxon. They announced that they were divesting from fossil fuels and one of their family foundations would be divesting and moving the money to renewable energy, which is pretty exciting. So here is where I think this relates to a polluter pays principle, because we have always known that fossil fuel divestment was not going to bankrupt Exxon, right? Somebody else is going to buy up the stocks if UBC sells them off. But the point is that as this debate plays out in our communities, in our schools, our workplaces, our faith organizations, as we talk to each other about the immorality of this business model, those profits are being delegitimized. And it's this illegitimacy that is key to establishing a polluter pays principle. And you know, this really came home to me when I heard Valerie Rockefeller Wayne explain on behalf of her family that it's precisely, and this is a quote, because our wealth was made through oil, that they are under greater moral obligation to use that wealth to stop climate change. And she's right, they are. But it can't stop at individuals and foundations, and nor can this principle be enforced voluntarily. It's lovely to get the Rockefeller brothers investing in renewable energy, but we need Exxon's profits, $42 billion in a single year, more than any single company has ever made. And I explore in the book that fossil fuel companies have been pledging for more than a decade, well over a decade, to voluntarily start moving their profits into investments in renewable energy. Most famously, British Petroleum rebranded itself Beyond Petroleum, even got a new logo with a starburst, and it was inspired by Helios, the god of the sun, and so on. And then a few years later, they were like, well, actually, maybe not, and they sold off their renewable assets and doubled down on some of the dirtiest fossil fuels on the planet, including in the Alberta tar sands. Today, most of the major oil companies spend less than 1% of their budgets on renewables. They probably spend more filming windmills for their advertisements. In my book, I go after Richard Branson pretty extensively. Some people say I was unfair to him. The reason why I go after Branson is actually because I think he was on to something. And this is that in 2006, he had this climate epiphany where Al Gore went to his house and gave him a personal PowerPoint presentation. And this is what happens when you're a billionaire. And Branson had what he described as his road to Damascus moment. And he decided that he had to do something, and yes, he ran several airlines, and that he would take 100% of the profits from his transportation businesses, so the airlines and also his diesel burning trains, and spend that money coming up with a green fuel and fighting climate change. And he pledged to spend $3 billion over 10 years. And this got him no end of good publicity, and it was pretty impressive. But like all things announced, you know, at the Clinton Global Initiative, as this was, there's no follow-up. It was up to me and my underpaid researchers to, you know, audit and just see, okay, has he done it? We're 8 years in, and we're in the millions, not the billions, and he has made it clear that he's not going to get anywhere near that target. He made that clear in an interview with me. And he also did say that if his airlines weren't profitable, then he would take it from other parts of the Virgin Empire. So what's interesting is what he actually did with the money in this period, because it's true that the airlines weren't profitable, but part of the reason they weren't profitable is because he was spending all the excess capital he had launching new airlines. So he launched Virgin America, he launched a new British domestic airline, he launched a new Australian airline. So we also looked at what his emissions looked like in this same period, and they were up by 40%. Okay? So the point is, his original idea was really good. We really do need to take the profits from the dirtiest industries, the industries at the heart of this crisis, to help us get off fossil fuels. But it cannot be voluntary. We cannot leave this to the goodwill of billionaires. We have to legislate it. You know, in the book, I look at a few other ways in which this ideological project clashes quite dramatically. One are the free trade deals that are increasingly being used as weapons against really good climate policies. I live in Ontario now. We had a good green energy program that had ambitious carbon reduction targets, but the way it was able to be sold politically is that it required that anybody who was going to take advantage of the feed-in tariff program had to produce between 40 to 60% of their wind turbines and solar panels in Ontario. It was a job creation program, and it was launched in the midst of the 2009 recession at the same time as the big three automakers were collapsing. It was a good news story. 31,000 manufacturing jobs were created in Ontario. I profile in the book a solar plant that had previously been an auto parts factory, and it was closed down and reopened as a solar plant, and a lot of the workers who were making solar panels had previously worked at Magna and Chrysler. So it was like the perfect just transition story until the European Union and Japan challenged Ontario at the World Trade Organization, and they said, well, this is discrimination. You're not allowed to favor local businesses. You have to treat our companies exactly on par with your own. And this is the language of human rights that has been adopted by the corporate sector. We were discriminating against, you know, Japanese and European solar companies. And the WTO ruled against Ontario. And it's true. This is why many of us were fighting those deals in the first place, because we argued that they were attacks on democracy and they were attacks on our ability to make sound industrial policy. We're also seeing challenges to movement victories, like Quebec's hard-won fracking moratorium. It's the kind of policy that everybody should have. Hint, hint. And right now, Quebec's moratorium is being challenged by a U.S. company that says that it violates its right to frack for gas under the St. Lawrence. So we're seeing these challenges more and more. The other thing that we're seeing is that when countries decide to get serious about transitioning to renewable energy, it also starts to conflict with the ideology of privatization. And where we see this really clearly is Germany, because of course in this period, this when thinking about the bad timing that the climate crisis has had, you know, it hit us in the very years that our governments were selling off the energy companies, the transit companies, that are really at the heart of making this just transition. So when you don't have control over your energy and your transit systems, it's harder to change quickly. Now, in Germany, they are changing quickly, and this is very much a movement victory. There's a very strong environmental movement in Germany, particularly a strong anti-nuclear movement in Germany, and in the aftermath of the Fukushima disaster, the energy transition in Germany started really speeding up. Merkel announced that she was going to phase out nuclear, and now 25% of Germany's electricity is coming from renewable energy, much of it wind and solar, much of it decentralized. It's created 400,000 jobs. And one of the reasons, one of the ways this is happening is that in hundreds of cities, big cities like Hamburg and small towns, people are voting to take back control over their energy systems that had been privatized in the 1990s. And they're doing this through referendums, they're doing it at the municipal level. And it's really exciting because this is being described as increasingly as an energy democracy movement. And this is a sort of a real win-win where not only are we getting good action on renewable energy, but the part of what is working about this, the reason why people want to do it, is because it's keeping resources in communities that are facing austerity, right? So they're generating the energy, they're feeding into the grid, and they aren't seeing the profits hemorrhage into the pockets of private shareholders. They're able to capture them and use them to fund services. And this is a good part of what is behind the momentum for Germany's quite spectacular energy transition. But I'm sure you've heard it isn't all good news, because despite the fact that they've been moving so quickly to renewable energy, Germany's emissions are still going up marginally, and they have for the past couple of years. Some years they go down, but the past couple of years they've gone up a little bit. And this is because Germany is continuing to produce coal, and while Angela Merkel has been willing to say yes to renewable energy, she hasn't been willing to say no to the fossil fuel lobby, the same problem we have here at home. And so even as demand for coal goes down in Germany, they're just exporting it. And they're leaving the control of coal to that weak European emission trading system. And that's no kind of counterpower. It's not able to do the job. So we need a movement that is both saying yes to what we want, but is also saying no to what we don't want. We need politicians willing to do it, but since we don't have politicians, we increasingly have social movements that are stepping into that leadership vacuum and are saying no. This movement is increasingly being called Blockadia, which is a phrase that that came out of the movement against the Keystone XL pipeline in the United States, building the southern leg, as ranchers and indigenous people started blocking the pipeline with their bodies. They called their camps Blockadia. And in the book, I talk about Blockadia as this sort of roving transnational protest zone that we're seeing crop up wherever these extreme energy projects are moving ahead. It's not a specific location. It is a fighting spirit taking on the coal mines, the gas fracking, the tar sands pipelines. And what's interesting is if you spend enough time in this place called Blockadia, you notice similarities, even the same slogans on signs like water is life, you can't eat money, draw the line. It's a movement that's often described as anti-fossil fuels, but it is in fact a movement united by a fierce commitment to protect water and a ferocious love of place. Many of these movements, as you know here in BC, are led by Indigenous people using their land and title rights to block planet destabilizing projects at every level. And this is more than a change in strategy for the environmental movement. It's a fundamental change in perspective and values. For decades, large parts of the movement spoke the borrowed language of risk assessment, action necessary to save humanity from the very real risks of climate chaos were coolly balanced against the risks such actions would pose to GDPs, as if economic growth still had meaning on a planet convulsing in serial disasters. In Blockadia, risk assessment has been abandoned on the barricaded roadside. Because when what is being fought for is not an abstract emission reduction target, but an identity, a culture, a beloved place that people are determined to pass on to their grandchildren and that at times has been paid for in blood, there is nothing companies can offer as a bargaining chip. No safety pledge will assuage, no bribe will be big enough. These communities aren't negotiating. They're simply saying no. No to the pipeline, no to the mine, no to the coal and oil trains. No to the export terminals, no to fracking, and not just not in my backyard, but as the French anti-fracking activists say, ni ici, ni ailleurs. Not here nor elsewhere. And this movement is starting to win. Win state and province-wide fracking bans and moratoriums from Quebec to New York State, countrywide fracking bans from France to the Czech Republic. Blockadia has led to cancellations of massive coal export terminals in the Pacific Northwest. It is spreading investor uncertainty through the Alberta tar sands, with new developments being put on ice because it is not at all clear that it will be possible to get the heavy oil out once it's mined. And we just saw this from Statoil when they announced that they were putting on hold a major expansion project of a mine, and they said that one of the reasons was uncertainty over pipeline capacity. Well done, BC. And that is just the beginning, because local fights are morphing into guiding principles. No new carbon frontiers, from the Arctic to the Amazon. No new sacrifice zones. We can power our lives without poisoning anyone. Justice and reparations for the communities that have already suffered the most on the old model. And this is key, because here in Canada, as we know, this is a movement that is led overwhelmingly by First Nations, from Coast Salish territories to Elsipuktuk. And a lot of the key battles are being fought in court, and they're enormously expensive. There are heavy costs associated with that. And we all need to step up in this moment and share that burden. We can't offload the financial burden of fighting for all of our futures on some of the poorest communities in this country. So I want to do a little plug for a great campaign called pulltogether.ca, pull-together.ca, which is a legal fund supporting First Nations that are defending their traditional territories in court. And the ask is not just to send money, but to organize fundraisers. But we need to do more than that. We need to support the growing movement attempting to bring renewable energy projects to First Nations first. Projects owned and controlled by the communities themselves. There's a move in Alberta, for instance, to bring that kind of community-controlled renewable energy to some of the communities that are on the front lines of tar sands extraction, so they are no longer forced to make those impossible choices between jobs and poisoning their own people. These are impossible choices, and we need to fight for those better options, as well as supporting the lawsuits. So, just wrapping up, you may have heard a little of this. I've been getting a little bit of pushback from friends in the environmental movement who say, did you have to use the C word? You know, climate was already big enough. Did you have to make it about capitalism? Now, I understand their concern, but here's the thing. It's not like we're talking about an economy that is working beautifully except for the small matter of rising sea levels. We're talking about allowing sea levels to rise in the name of protecting an economic system that is failing the vast majority of people with or without climate change. When we widen our focus as opposed to narrow it, it becomes possible to see how the climate movement can build the sort of counterpower that could actually win in the scarce time we have next left. I'm convinced that climate change represents a historic opportunity on the scale of the New Deal, what some have called a Marshall Plan for planet Earth. As part of the project of getting our emissions down to the levels many scientists recommend, we once again have the chance to advance policies that dramatically improve lives. Rather than the ultimate expression of the shock doctrine, a frenzy of new resource grabs and repression, climate change can be a people's shock. A blow from below. It can disperse power into the hands of the many rather than consolidating it into the hands of the few, and radically expand the commons rather than auctioning it off in pieces. You want a big political tent? Try the Earth's atmosphere. We're all under it already. We just have to start acting like it. Thank you.
Mark Lee will now join Ms. Klein and go through questions that we've taken from the audience. Thank you.
So I understand that cards are floating around and they're supposed to be brought up to me so that I can ask questions to Naomi, and I don't have any yet. So I'll start with one, because I was sitting there thinking about this potential moment happening. You mentioned First Nations at the beginning, and it's really nice to have the acknowledgement of First Nations territory and the significant legal fights that are coming. Talk more about that in the Canadian context and what you see happening in Alberta and British Columbia right now.
Well, I think I wanted to stress these two pieces of it, which is the need to support the actual lawsuits, and also what we're hearing from more and more communities that are engaged in these extraordinarily expensive battles, that what they need, as well as support for the lawsuits, is support for economic alternatives in the longer term. And this idea, I think, it goes well beyond First Nations, this principle that the people who have been on the front lines of our toxic economic model should be first in line to benefit from the transition. Is a really good sort of rule of thumb for what a just transition should actually mean. In the book, I talk about the Beaver Lake Cree First Nations lawsuit. A lot of people know about the Athabasca Chippewa suit because that was the one that Neil Young toured with supporting. And interestingly, they've just installed some of their first solar panels, because this issue just keeps coming up again and again, that we need our no, but we also need our yes. But the Beaver Lake Cree lawsuit is, in many ways, well, just as significant, and we often hear less about it, because they're suing the provincial government, the federal government, and the British Crown for 15,000 treaty violations related to tar sands extraction. What I see is just so significant about it is this broader shift, where if we think about the aftermath of Delgamuukw in this province, where so often the way I remember the story playing out after Delgamuukw was this, this really kind of inflammatory coverage of whenever First Nations went out and exercised their court-affirmed title rights to fish or log, exercise their rights, it was reported on as this is something that is taking away from non-native British Columbians. And there were really pitched battles. There were terrible battles after the Marshall decision on the East Coast, like, straight-up race riots, right, in New Brunswick. And so if we think about what we're seeing now around Al-Sabuktuk and the fracking fights and the way in which it brought together different First Nations, Acadians, English-speaking New Brunswickers, and then the way in which the Northern Gateway fight and the broader anti-tanker movement has brought together the different constituencies, but in a spirit of gratitude for First Nations rights that is so different from what we saw a decade and a half ago. Not to say that everything is perfect now, but I feel like there's a really significant shift where, you hear at meetings all the time, an understanding that really the best hope of legal hope of standing up to Stephen Harper's extractive agenda are the legal rights of First Nations people. And that's why there is such a profound moral responsibility to financially support those struggles.
All right, thank you. And now I've now been flooded with questions, so I will try to sift through. Whoa, okay. Settle in for a long night, folks. All right, here's one. How much of a reduction in consumption would we need to see to make a meaningful dent in climate change, and would this amount be palatable with the public?
So in the book, I rely really heavily on a couple of climate experts in England, Kevin Anderson and Alice Bowes at the Tyndall Centre, because I think they've They're very, very well respected. I haven't seen anybody challenge their numbers. And they're just really brave and honest in terms of just saying, yeah, we are going to have to consume less, which is something that a lot of people try to sort of sugarcoat and claim isn't really true. It won't hurt a bit. You won't even notice. You know, we're just going to transform the entire economy. It'll be easy. No problem. So the issue with Michael Mann, the climate scientist who wrote The Hockey Stick and The Climate Wars, he talks about the procrastination penalty, right? The procrastination penalty being, you know, if this were 1992, we could have done it gradually. But it's not 1992. And sometimes we still talk as if it is. But if we're talking about 8 to 10% reductions, then what Anderson and Bose say is that our consumption levels have to be about what they were in the 1970s. So it doesn't mean you have to like wear bell bottoms unless you want to. But I mean, it's interesting because you know the 80s were the turning point really when consumption became you know a way of life, right? I mean, it was sort of like that shift that you know this is what I wrote about No Logo was that you know that moment when it became about lifestyle branding and it that shift coincided with the ascendancy of the neoliberal project for really obvious reasons because we were losing our community, right? I mean, the institutions where we used to derive meaning were fraying because they were under attack from this project. So, we, you know, in the absence of community, you get your community from your running shoes and your cup of coffee and so on. And, you know, that's what all that marketing was about. So it's not back to the Stone Ages or whatever, you know, I mean, can we live with consumption levels that that were about what they were in the 1970s? It doesn't seem like such an incredible march. But it does mean that we need to engage in what they call strategic degrowth, which isn't a really fantastic term. I think it could use some better messaging. So I've been talking about a deliberate economy, which means that you decide which areas you want to grow and which areas you want to contract, right? So there are large parts of our economy that are not heavy on resource use. I mean, the healthcare, education, the arts. So we can expand those low-carbon parts of our economy. The tricky thing about that 8 to 10% emission reduction is that in the short term of rolling out all of this great new infrastructure that we've been talking about, you're going to burn a lot of fossil fuels. You have to. This is the irony: is that you've got to burn a lot of fossil fuels to get off fossil fuels when you have an economy based on fossil fuels. So while we do that, we're going to have to contract deliberately some of our consumption use.
Okay, thanks. So this one I struggle with as well, so I'm asking you all the hard questions that, you know,
Thanks. I was planning on asking you all the, what do you think, Mark?
And this relates to, you know, some of the challenges we see in rural and resource-dependent parts, and very true for large swaths of Canada. So how do we communicate with workers in the natural resources sector, including those in the labor movement, about the importance of alternative and renewable energy sources and fuels?
Yeah, so, I mean, I think this yes-no thing is, I really think, needs to be a kind of a mantra for how we move forward, and I think we have made mistakes in the climate movement of, you know, just for instance, I would say that there's now pretty widespread acceptance that in the Keystone XL fight, for instance, we should have, from day one, been talking about the jobs that could have been created if the same amount of money was spent on renewable energy. You know, 3 years into the campaign, there was a fantastic project by Bold Nebraska, where they built this barn in the pathway of the pipeline that was powered entirely by renewable energy and would bring more power to the surrounding community than the Keystone XL pipeline would. And that was great. Like, that was a great sort of demonstration project. But, you know, the research that you did, Mark, about, you know, what could we do if we spent the money, the proposed money from Northern Gateway on renewable energy? How many more jobs would that create? I mean, that kind of research is incredibly important, but it has to move beyond beyond research. Like, we actually need to start doing it. And this is what, the other thing that excites me about the fossil fuel divestment movement is the possibility for it really turning into a divest-invest movement, which we're starting to see, so that while our governments twiddle their thumbs and fail to invest in the real solutions, we could start funneling some of the money that's being moved out of away from fossil fuel companies into, for instance, these types of projects that would bring renewable energy to First Nations communities, or just transition projects, like, for instance, Richmond, California. This is a community that is, you know, has been hugely dependent on their single largest employer, which is a Chevron refinery. And they have very deliberately launched this movement of solar co-ops, you know, geared towards the workers who would have to go work at Chevron. So this weaving in of the of the alternatives into the resistance movements, I think it needs to guide everything we do. Like, in terms of Alberta right now, like, they are scared, right? They're scared because their government has so badly mismanaged this boom, right? They have a deficit at the end of this resource boom, and now the price of oil is getting so low that it is starting to become dodgy about whether or not it is economic to mine for tar sands. We don't know how long that's going to last, but certainly when I was in Alberta last week, There was a great deal of openness about the fact that Alberta, you know, is poised to take advantage of solar and wind and geothermal, like, better than almost any in North America. And, you know, I think that the messaging has to be that the skills that are needed for those jobs are the same skills. It's the pipe fitters and the engineers. It's the same skills. And this is what the fossil fuel companies have done so well, is to equate their own interests, their corporate interests, with the interests of workers, as if these are one and the same. So I think the task of the movement, and it can only be done with the labor movement, is to pry those two things apart and say, actually, no, you know, you don't have to be a stranded asset. your skills are transferable, and these are the policies that are going to retrain you, and we'll have more jobs. Make a book.
Yeah, I didn't come up here with a system for organizing all of these questions, so I'm going to do my best. I'm amalgamating a couple questions here, but they're both around diet and meat and vegetarianism and fossil fuel consumption. Can you comment on that?
Yeah. So I think that this, you know, it's definitely the changing our agricultural system, taking on big ag, moving to a much less fossil fuel intensive agricultural system, you know, is a huge part of the transition that we need to make. It's also a great example of how the things that we need to do to lower our emissions also make us healthier, improve quality of life. We're going to eat better, and we do need to have a more plant-based diet. In terms of how you legislate something like that, I mean, I think what you do is you build, you know, as many incentives as you can. But I think the idea of sort of legislating vegetarianism, for instance, that I know that some people think that would be a good idea. I don't see it. I also do think that there are, you know, pretty serious issues around cultural rights and how important meat is in a lot of cultures, including indigenous culture. But we're talking about factory farming when we're talking about the connection with emissions, right? And it is a huge contributor to emissions.
Okay, so this is switching tax completely. But there are a couple questions, you know, relating to the topic of capitalism, you know, naming the C word, and, you know, well, if not capitalism, then what? So when you take a crack at that, you have 3 minutes.
Yeah. Well, I only got 20 seconds when I was on news. What would you like to replace capitalism with? You have 20 seconds. I did debate the issue about whether or not to name it as capitalism, and I think, you know, the biggest downside of it is that we're still stuck in this binary Cold War mindset that, you know, if you're criticizing capitalism, then you're advocating state socialism. If you read the book, you know, then it's really clear that I definitely acknowledge that state socialism was just as bad for the climate as industrial capitalism. And indeed, one of the few times when we've seen an serious emission reduction is when the economies of the Soviet Union collapsed in the 1990s. The other moment where we saw a serious reduction was after the financial crisis in 2008. So whether it's communism collapsing or capitalism collapsing, the planet seems to like it. misquoted. No, but the truth is that it isn't just about capitalism. It is about a worldview based on extractivism, an instrumentalist worldview that is deeply tied to seeing the earth as a machine. And industrial socialism saw the earth as a machine. Mao declared war on nature quite proudly. That was the slogan. and the truth is that many of the so-called 21st century socialist governments in Latin America are pursuing pretty relentless extractivist policies, whether it's Venezuela, Ecuador, Bolivia, and putting themselves in conflict with indigenous people in their own countries, Brazil, because they aren't challenging the extractivist mindset, and there are counter movements in Latin America that are articulating what a non-extractivist worldview would look like. And so the benefit of naming it as capitalism is, you know, that's the stand-in for our economy, you know? And we definitely need to change our economic system. And as I said, it challenges growth, right? I mean, if we're talking about 8 to 10% a year, we're not just talking about returning to a Keynesian regulated system pre-free trade deals. That won't cut it, because that is basically just an argument over how we're going to redistribute it. I know I'm going over my 3 minutes, but it is a challenge to capitalism, but it's also a deeper challenge than capitalism, and it really challenges us to imagine a system that is unlike anything we've tried before.
All right, I have a question around, almost the flip side of capitalism, which was democracy, and, you know, that the state of our electoral system, not so good. Are there any bright spots in there? Are there fundamental electoral or democratic reform changes you see that need to be made to be consistent with the view you're articulating in the book?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, what I've encountered most on the road, touring with it, is just this feeling of our system is too broken to deal with this crisis, right? Whether it's broken because people feel that their democracies are so controlled by corporate money, or because they feel that their democracies are non-functional and non-responsive, and so whether it means, you know, a financial reform of you know, how we finance elections, or whether it is about something like proportional representation, I do think that it forces those structural discussions, and that is certainly what I'm finding as I talk about this with people, that it isn't that there's so much resistance to the idea of what needs to change, that people feel like they don't have the tools to change. You know, the bright side of that is that this could be a catalyst for the kinds of changes we know we need anyway. I mean, these are issues that come up again and again. They are what stand in the way of pretty much anything progressive you could ever hope to accomplish. So, my thing is I'm a writer, so I really believe deadlines are helpful, you know. I wrote, you know, this book took me 5 years to write, but I wrote 80% of it in the last 6 months. So I overly value deadlines, but I feel like, you know, these are things that we know are broken, but we all sort of sit around and complain about it and don't, you know, that we don't work together in the kinds of coalitions that we need and with the focus that we need to actually achieve this level of change. So, and we spend a lot of time looking away from climate change, right? I mean, this is how I start the book, is sort of all the ways in which we, you know, just sort of look at this for a minute and then look away. you know, I don't believe we've sort of fully let in the that the power actually that this can have over us, because we're afraid. We don't, you know, we don't know what to do with the fear. So if it is attached to a transformative project, then I think we can both look and leap.
When you actually look at climate change and you know you get into the weeds, it takes you to some pretty dark places. And so, do you have any advice for young people who are, you know, just getting started? How do you find the hope?
So one other thing about the sort of, just to get concrete about the sort of democratic changes that we need, you know, Germany, and I think I was talking about this with a great group of young people earlier who are part of Next Up earlier today. We had a meeting. I think that Germany is a really good example because it points to the fact that a country that I think Canadians can relate to is in the midst of this kind of amazing transformation, created so many jobs. It also shows the sorts of intersections that you need, right? You need a mass movement, a movement that ranges from hundreds of thousands of people in the streets to people willing to engage in direct action. Germany has it all when it comes to environmental activism. But they also have a more responsive system. Like Hamburg voted to take their electricity grid because they have a mechanism that allows them to do that. Every 20 years when their contracts expire, there's an automatic ability to reevaluate whether you want to have private electricity or not, right? So it shows that, you know, building in these more, you know, participatory mechanisms really help. People can use them, and they're using them in hundreds of cities. Another thing that Germany shows is, if you have better proportional representation, then left parties can have a real impact. It's interesting that this is happening in Germany under a right-wing government. Merkel is not a lefty. But the left parts of the plan are thanks to the left-wing party in German parliament that pushed to make sure that the plan would favor decentralized renewable energy, energy co-op. There are 900 new energy co-ops in Germany as part of this transition. So it shows all these things. It shows, you know, the power of local participation, referendums, a more functioning parliamentary system, and it also shows the limits of it because they haven't been willing to stand up to coal, and, you know, it can't really be called a climate victory until their emissions start going down every year, you know?
So Germany's a good segue to the next question, which is a nice...
Oh, I didn't ask about the answer about the hope.
Oh, we'll get there. What's your opinion on nuclear?
It's interesting because Germany is often held up as, oh, this proves that, you know, we need nuclear. But the thing is this transition would not be happening in Germany if there was not an anti-nuclear movement. It's not like Merkel woke up one day and was just like, I want to get rid of nuclear. No, she was under massive pressure from below, right? So now they need to improve that. But the idea that this sort of happened at a sort of policy wonk level and not at the level of movement pressure. So people feel passionate about nuclear. They're scared of nuclear. They do not want the waste in Germany. It's about the fact that a lot of France's nuclear waste is traveling through Germany, and people don't want those risks. This is why I say that it's not just about capitalism, it's about extractivism. It's about a worldview that sees sacrifice zones as acceptable. So here I'm talking about the kind of nuclear power that we actually have. I'm not talking about next generation nuclear that doesn't exist. I'm talking about the kind of nuclear power that we have and the kind of nuclear power that is actually being introduced now. And that nuclear power has high levels of risk at every stage, at the extractive project, at the reactor level, and also at the waste disposal level, right? So I think at the heart of where we have gone wrong is this idea that that we need to power our societies by sacrificing people in places that are considered less important. And I see nuclear as requiring that mentality in even upping the ante. So don't see it as a solution. I also don't think it's necessary. Mark Jacobson at Stanford University, you know his research, you know, he shows that it's possible for us to get to 100% renewable by 2030 or 2050 without nuclear and without unconventionals, right? So yes, we need fossil fuels for this transition, but we don't need fracked gas and we don't need tar sands oil. We can do it with conventionals. But that's really politically hard. That's really politically hard. That only happens if you are willing to have this battle with the fossil fuel sector, and that requires a much more dramatic change in society. Because the thing about decentralized renewable is that it is a more democratic system. It's not that no one's going to make money, but nobody's going to make the kind of stupid money that you make from fossil fuels. And so I think that it's easier to imagine flipping a switch from fossil fuels to nuclear, which is a sort of a corporatist technology. It's big tech. It's, you know, it relies on this same sort of convergence between heavy industry and government subsidies, and it's why the right favors nuclear more than renewables, because it's kind of a manly technology and so on. I could talk about nuclear all day. I'm not a fan of nuclear. I don't think it's a climate solution. And I do think that this crisis demands us to dig deep at the roots of why we are where we are. And there are ways that we can respond to this crisis that will put us at greater risk. And nuclear, I believe, is one of them, especially in a future of heavy weather, right? I mean, this intersection of dangerous technology and volatile weather is not one we like post-Fukushima. You know, if we don't challenge that hubristic worldview, the other place that leads is geoengineering, which is something else that I explore in the book, right? I mean, this idea of, you know, even going further down this road that we can dominate the Earth, and thinking that we can hack the planet and spray sulfur into the stratosphere and take on these massive risks. I mean, these technologies, a lot of modeling shows that they would interfere with Asia and Africa's summer monsoons. You're gambling with the food systems of, you know, billions of people, yet this is being seen as a more serious technology than putting solar panels on people's roofs, right? Because it doesn't challenge power in the same way.
So we're already well after 8:30, so we'll just take a couple more and then we'll let you get on with your evening. A few people want to know, several actually, have you ever thought about running for political office?
I don't think I'm cut out for it, but thank you for asking. Thanks for asking. No, but I feel like, you know, I definitely want to engage with the electoral process in Canada. I don't want to run as a candidate, but I think we need to be thinking, you know, very seriously about strategy and how we get better alternatives on the table. I mean, I'm pretty deeply disappointed with the fact that both Justin Trudeau and Thomas Mulcair have picked their pipelines and cheered for them. And I think that, you know, we need opposition parties that are willing to have a bold vision for this country that is not based on extractivism, that is a genuine counter narrative to what we're hearing from Harper, and that it isn't just like a kind of kinder, gentler, better regulated tar sands, but is really a shift. What about you, Mark?
Really? That's a closer.
Oh, that's a closer. No, we can take a couple more.
Yeah.
I certainly don't want to end on that.
All right, so a number of questions. We have an election coming up in Vancouver. Tankers are a big topic. Do you have any thoughts? Should Vancouver become a tanker-free zone?
Yes, please. Yes, please. all of the West Coast should be a tanker-free zone. Yes.
All right, so I'll ask one more wonky question. So a year from now, world governments are supposed to meet in Paris with the idea of hammering out a new international treaty on to constrain carbon emissions. How are you feeling about those? Do you have any optimism going into that, or what do you think needs to happen between now and then to affect real change?
Well, you know, I don't think we can afford to give up on the UN process. It's deeply flawed and getting more flawed. It was pretty alarming the extent to which this UN summit that just happened in New York was infiltrated by polluters. I went to the private sector forum, which they were very proud, had the highest number of CEOs at any UN gathering ever, and they were holding a kind of telethon for the Earth, where one CEO after another would stand up, and they called it the 1 minute to save the world, and it was all of this sort of voluntary nothing talk, you know, that we've been hearing for so long. They were not even convincing themselves, I promise you. There was even a guy from Saudi Aramco standing up, going, "The oil and gas industry is on board with climate action," and everyone's clapping, going, "What does that mean?" You know. So the last COP in Poland also had, you know, very heavy presence from the coal industry, and also I think it was the first COP with corporate sponsorship. So there's an interesting a proposal that's based on the model of the tobacco companies, where in the international forum that regulates tobacco marketing and distribution, the tobacco companies aren't allowed to be there. And this seems like an obvious point, but that the idea that you wouldn't allow fossil fuel companies into the negotiations about emission reduction seems like a good idea, right? I think that would help. And it isn't just the fossil fuel companies, also the private water companies are there in force, the big agribusiness companies. And this is important because, you know, the march in New York was a beautiful thing. It was 400,000 people in the streets, you know. And it was really a glimpse of the movement that we need to build, because it was not a march of the NGOs with people, you know, passing giant earth balls, you know. It was a climate justice march. It was led by indigenous people, including many indigenous people from the tar sands region. And it was, it was overwhelmingly filled with impacted communities. All those blockadia movements that I mentioned, the people who had won the moratorium on fracking in New York State, and, you know, were fighting for their water. You had a huge trade union presence. The nurses were out in force, connecting climate change with health, calling for universal health care. This fantastic contingent from the South Bronx, and their banners were all about how their kids had, you know, ridiculously high asthma rates, but they were also demanding climate jobs. And there was that, you know, that urgency, that closing of that urgency gap that I was talking about. That was the most exciting thing, to really feel that this is the movement that will fight for their kids, that will fight for clean air, will fight for their water, and will fight for the jobs and the infrastructure that they need, right? But the problem is, you know, the call was just for climate action. You know, dear leaders, give us action. And that is not, that's not, that we need climate justice. We don't just need climate action. And we need to sharpen that message ahead of Paris, because, you know, the climate action that's coming out of this sort of corporatist UN system more and more is about, you know, more GMOs, so-called smart agriculture, climate-ready crops, more privatization of water, and natural gas as a bridge fuel, all of this, right? Nuclear. So this idea of just sort of begging the UN to take action, I think the time, we need to have our eyes open about what is actually happening in the UN. We need to have clear demands about what we expect from the UN, that we want the polluters out. And there's some really good campaigns. I'll be writing more about them in the coming weeks, about how we can use the tobacco precedent on lots of fronts, actually, because you have just been writing about that, you know, that tobacco is a great precedent for lots of things, right, in terms of how you delegitimize these profits and then get your hands on those profits to fund, you know, in the case of tobacco, to fund the public health campaigns, to convince people to quit smoking and fund and cover healthcare costs. That's the kind of model that we need. And if we look at how we got there, it wasn't by playing nice with the tobacco companies, you know. You know, in the book I write about the greenhouse development rights framework, which I think is it's pretty wonky. You'd like it, but it's the best framework that I know of for what we should be asking of the UN system in terms of an equity-based response that doesn't let China and India off the hook, because you know the social movements in those countries don't want them off the hook. They don't want their kids choking on coal. When they send them to school wearing pollution masks. I mean, but it has to recognize the historical realities, and it has to, make more demands of the people who are able to change and not offload it onto the poor. Anyway, greenhouse development rights framework, I think, should be the sort of guiding demand for what we're asking of Paris if we want to get really, really wonky. Mark said that there was a question about the attacks in Ottawa related to my last book, and I would just say it is a moment to keep our heads, you know. I think, and I've been heartened that a lot of people have, you know, I liked what Elizabeth May said. You know, she said this doesn't change everything, but climate change does, you know. We have to keep this in perspective. I'm just rifling through my papers just because I think that there was something I wanted to say before this is all over. She shouldn't run for office. She's a mess. What are you talking about? Ridiculous behavior.
Someone will be writing your speaking notes for you.
I'll have a teleprompter. It'll be so slick. I just want to say, Mark, I want to thank tremendous work over the years. I rely on Mark's research so heavily. This is real ammo.
Thank you.
The revolution will be endnoted. And it will have many Mark Lee endnotes. Support the CCPA. Underneath all this wonky stuff, I think there is something that many of us know, you know, which is that this is a spiritual crisis. Fossil fuels, the promise of fossil fuels, was the promise of liberation from nature. That is what the first salesman for the steam engine promised. They said, you will no longer have to build your factory next to those pesky waterfalls and have to worry about water level. You can build your factory wherever you want, and you can, you won't have to worry about strikes. You can move to the big cities where there's surplus labor, and you can put it onto your boats, and you won't have to worry about when the wind blows and the world will become small, and you will transcend that dependency on the natural world. And, you know, climate change is nature going, that's what you think. I'm the boss. It is a message. It is not an issue to file next to healthcare and taxes. It is a message spoken in the language of storms and droughts, telling us that we need a radically different system and a radically different relationship with the earth and with one another. Telling us that we need to evolve. Thank you, everybody.
To thank Ms. Klein, I'd like to call upon our past president, Max Cameron, professor of political science and director of UBC's Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions. Max, thank you.
on behalf of the Vancouver Institute and our co-sponsor, the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives. Thank you, Naomi Klein, for that superb lecture and discussion. You've exemplified for us tonight the kind of engaging and informative discussions and events that we seek to encourage at the Vancouver Institute, which is Vancouver's premier town gown institution. We hold lectures throughout the academic year, every Saturday at 8:15. If you're interested in the Institute and our lectures, would like to join as a member, flyers are available in the lobby. But I'd also like to thank you on a more personal note, because I suspect that, like many people in the audience here, I feel a profound debt of gratitude to you. And as I was preparing my notes, I was thinking to myself, why do I feel this debt of gratitude? And I think of how sad I would be if we did not have your voice in our public debates. And I think of how devastated many of us would be if you were to stand here tonight and tell us there is no hope, it's irreversible, there's nothing we can do. I've given up, and you should too. We turn to Naomi Klein to understand our present predicament. I read her book with a book club, and we all agreed Naomi Klein connects the dots. Whether it's seeing the connection between reproductive rights and a healthy environment, whether it's connecting the dots that allows us to envisage blockadia, or whether it's seeing the way in which the debate on trade agreements has corrupted big environmental groups, Naomi Klein connects the dots. We also turn to Naomi for a sense of what we can do. And I think we will all take different things away from this marvelous book and from the talk and discussion tonight. I know that tomorrow morning I will be in the Lew Institute at 10 o'clock in the morning for the fall general meeting of the UBC Faculty Association, where we will be voting to divest UBC's fossil fuel investments. UBC should not profit from an industry that has, as Naomi says, every intention of pushing the planet beyond the boiling point. And thanks to the arguments made in this book, we can also make the case for reinvesting in renewable energy. I see many UBC faculty members here tonight. I hope you will all turn out for tomorrow's meeting. It cannot be entirely easy to occupy the role in the public imagination that Naomi does. And many of the more personal passages of this book, and in some of the things that Naomi has said tonight, we get a sense of how she carries the weight of the world on her shoulder. For that, for her passionate urgency, for her sharp mind, and her commitment to a cooler, fairer, and more equal world, we are so very grateful.